sections.
Good evening and welcome to Birkbeck Science Week. I'm Nick Keepholm, the Dean of Science, and it's my great pleasure to introduce Charlie Underwood this evening. But before we go on to Charlie, just a few notices about Science Week. As you'll see if you come in, there's a short reception after this. There's food and drink, because at 7 o'clock there's a second lecture by Dr. James Hammond, again from Earth and Planetary Sciences, who's going to be talking about his experiences of a volcano on the North Korean-Chinese border. Even if you haven't signed up for that talk, you're more than welcome to stay for it. And do stay for drinking and some nibbles, even if you can't stay right through to 8 o'clock. So it's my great pleasure to introduce Charlie this evening. Charlie did his undergraduate degree at Exeter, moved to Bristol for his PhD, and then a short time as a lecturer in Liverpool before coming to Birkbeck. Not long after I did, though, his hair seems to have survived the experience rather better than mine. So anyway,
more of it than me.
Okay, wonderful. So Charlie's going to talk about his interest in pulling shark's teeth.
Okay, thanks very much. Well, what I want to really talk about is... is really talk about, I suppose, a transition, as it were, between us as the life sciences and earth sciences, of how we can look at fossil organisms, in this case fossil sharks, and their modern relatives, and between them pull together a range of different sorts of data and forms and of analyses to get a sort of an integrated view, which will hopefully generate things that will interest both people working on the fossil record and evolution, but also people working on modern organisms, modern sharks in this case, and what they actually mean in the larger sense. So, what are we dealing with? Well, firstly of all vertebrates, or animals with backbones, there are essentially two groups. There's the groups which have proper bones in their body, that's bony fish and us, we're just rather special bony fish. And there's the other group, that's the sharks, the rays, and the weird and wonderful group of chimeras. And these two groups split very, very early on in the ancestry of vertebrates. Probably over 400 million years ago. Within both of these groups, there's one very special group of organs that are probably instrumental to their success, and that's teeth. And one thing that's of particular interest is, have teeth evolved once before this split, or have they evolved on multiple occasions since this split between the two vertebrate groups? We know about teeth in animals with bones very well. There's lots of modelling has been done on mice and zebrafish, and even managed to trigger teeth to grow within chickens. But what we don't know is much about the teeth within this other group, and so whether we can unite teeth within these two major vertebrate groups. The other great thing with working with teeth of sharks and their relatives is they fossilise extremely well. They're made of a mineral called apatite, a phosphate mineral, which is highly crystalline and preserves in the fossil record very, very well indeed. There's also an awful lot of them. As you'll see later, sharks produce huge numbers of teeth during their lifespan and shed them continuously. So you get thousands of potential fossils for each individual. And because they're shed during life, we find the fossils where the animals lived rather than just where they died and their carcasses ended up. And also, because their teeth are so disposable, the teeth of sharks have a great advantage over the teeth of mammals such as us. We only replace our teeth once. We have one set of little teeth, one with small children, and then we have another set that lasts us the rest of our lives. That means the teeth have to be strong, they have to be robust. They have to be a great compromise between their function and how long they'll last. Sharps, it doesn't matter. If they're shaped continuously, as long as the tooth has enabled one good meal, it doesn't matter if it's broken in the process. It doesn't matter if it's blunted. It'll fall out and another one will come up anyway. So there's no compromise between form and function. Fossil sharks we find in several different ways. Very occasionally, find things like this. A whole skeleton, and you can see this is a skeleton of a small cat shark, much like the spotted dogfish that gets around Britain today. And you can see the shape of the body, the pectoral fins, the caudal fin at the back, the head, you might just be able to see the mouth with lots of little teeth in it, and it's actually some skull bones of a bony fish in its stomach. But because their skeleton is largely cartilage, albeit hardened cartilage, they tend to fall apart and decay very rapidly. So most of the fossils we get are like this. These are isolated teeth, and you can see they're present in sometimes absolutely vast quantities. This is a photo in the courtyard of a fossil dealer in Morocco, where sharks are sold by the kilo. They're also incredibly variable in shape relating to their function. So here we've got a mako shark. This is a fast swimmer that grabs fast, slippery prey. So it needs slender, gripping teeth. And you can see those teeth are very good for grabbing hold of fast-moving fish. We have other sharks that feed on proportionally very large food, including carrion, and need to be able to slice large lumps out of it. So we have teeth that are more blade-like. This is a deep water thing, a kite fin shark. And here these serrated teeth fit together to form a sort of almost a saw blade. And these will both eat medium-sized food, but these will scavenge on dead whales and be able to take nice little hemispheres of flesh out of them. But we've also got to include the rays, which are effectively just squashed sharks after all. And these have teeth that are even more variable. These are the teeth of a bat ray, and the teeth in the middle of the jaw here are almost paving slabs. They're flat, they're wide, and they're immensely strong. This is a thing that eats thick shell mollusks, crabs, lobsters, and so on. And so their jaws act almost like a pestle of mortar. And we have rays with a rather more varied diet, but again with these flat, crushing teeth. This is a type of catarrhfish that feeds on wide range of things, including other rays, but also these rounded teeth allow it to crush up things like crabs and lobsters without any difficulty. So, a great variety of form and function. Now, there's many ways we can look at these teeth, and particularly we wanted to look at how they grow within individuals and what they might mean in an evolutionary sense. Now we can look at the fossils, and we'll come back to that in a bit. But one great way of doing it is to look at modern examples. And modern sharks and rays, easy to get hold of, and of course we can see the teeth in context. Now we can dissect them, a messy, smelly, and I think rather interesting process. But a new method that's turned out to be extremely useful is using a CT scan. This is the one in the Natural History Museum, and effectively it's a way of generating a three-dimensional X-ray image. So if we look inside the giant box, what we have here is a specimen in a plastic bag, just drying out and smelling too much, on a turntable which rotates, and then there's a source of X-rays here and a detector. So Effectively, you take hundreds of X-ray images as the turntable goes round, and then in a computer, you can rejoin all those X-ray images together to get a three-dimensional image. And that image you can manipulate in many ways. So here, this is a juvenile format skate, a very common thing around the British coast. So here we've scanned it, and now we can remove the less dense or less X-ray opaque tissues to see the skeleton underneath. And we can also virtually dissect it. So here we're slicing away one of the wings, one of the pectoral fins, and seeing the side of the skull. And you can see where the optic nerve goes in, cross-section through the jaws, and so on. So this is an immensely powerful mechanism for looking at the internal structures, or hard internal structures. Of course, we have to get in there and get hands dirty as well. This is part of a sort of almost a dissectathon that we did with a marine research lab. That's a large hall beagle shark that was taken to the Natural History Museum. This is a Suffolk Marine Research Lab had a freezer with 50 protected hall beagle sharks in that had been brought up dead in nets. They said, we need to clean our freezer out, do you want them? Well, of course. Who'd say no? So I helped myself to some. And this is one I helped myself to. This is the head of a hall beagle shark. This is the commonest midwater predatory shark around Britain. It's a cold water shark. So we're here rotating the head. You can see there are those little pores for the electrode sense organs. So as before, we're slicing back, removing the less X-ray dense material, skin, the muscle, the blood, and so on, revealing this mineralized cartilage underneath. And you can see the large jaws here. They're not, unlike with a mammal like us, the jaws, you see, aren't actually strongly connected to the skull. They're very mobile and can move relative to the skull, giving them a lot of mobility. And you can see here the teeth. As we remove everything else, the most X-ray dense material left are the teeth, which we can see we can virtually extract them from this specimen. If we look at these in a bit more detail, here is a little section of jaw of another hall beagle shark from there. And in this we can see very clearly how shark's teeth form and are replaced. So if we again, animation on. So this is the inside of the jaw. In this case, we've got some sort of skin on the inside. There is the cartilage, which has this hardened sort of skin around the edge of it. And on the inside of the jaw, the teeth form on a conveyor belt, move up to the jaw edge, where they're used. As they blunten and break, they fall off. So here we've removed everything apart from the teeth. You can see there's the developing teeth, which are just little points, and then as they progress up this conveyor belt, the teeth become progressively more complete. So the enameloid, the hard outer covering film, forms first, then the dentine, then the root, and finally you have these fully formed teeth, which then fall out. So we have this continuous conveyor belt system of tooth replacement. And that's why we get so many sharks within the fossil record. Because of that, we can think of the teeth being replaced almost as a whirl or as a spiral. And of course, this is completely different to tooth replacement in us as mammals. Okay, we only do it once, we're not very good at replacing the teeth. But if we looked at things like crocodiles or lizards, The replacement is very different. The new tooth forms within the jawbone, comes up, and then pushes the old tooth out from the top. So the teeth are part of the jaw, emerge from the jaw, and push the old tooth out of the way. In this, the teeth are part of effectively the skin on the inside of the mouth, and never actually connected to the jaw at all. So they move around, pushing the other teeth out of the way as they go. So this is a coloured in still of that last animation. And so you can see here, this is the jaw cartilage. Now, it's often said that sharks have a cartilage skeleton, so it's all soft and squidgy. It is. It's made of cartilage, a soft material, but it's usually hardened with a layer of calcium phosphate, same mineral as makes bone, on the outside. So what you can see here is it's actually, this is where soft cartilage would have been, or is, and it's picked up on the CT, and here is this outer sort of crust of mineral, of hardened material. Here are the teeth, little tip forming there, and then they get bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger, and then they come through the skin up into their functional position. So the teeth are forming this sort of spiral. Now in some, and then the teeth shed. In modern sharks, that's what happens, but there are a few fossil examples where the teeth aren't shed, and these result in some fairly spectacular fossils. This is one of the weirdest. This is a thing called Helicoprion, which is a single tooth spiral, equivalent to that, from a shark-like thing from the Permian, so about 250 million years ago. And here, this is the form of teeth as they form. They're moving up, just as they are there, into the functional position at the top. And then rather than falling out, they continue to move, and the old used teeth end up in the middle of the spiral. So in life, this would have formed a bizarre, sort of almost circular saw sticking out from the middle of the jaw. That's something we'll come back to later. Now, there's been a lot of discussion about what sharks' teeth actually are. Clearly, they are associated with the skin, and sharks' skin is covered in little tiny tooth-like scales called denticles. They far more resemble teeth than the scales of the fish you're more familiar with. So, let's have a look at those. So here we've got a late embryo of a spotted dogfish, a really common thing around Britain. There's CT scan of the whole thing. This is just out of its egg case. It's made of the length of your finger. And this is a CT scan of its head using, we're just seeing the densest material. So just the teeth and these tooth-like scales, these denticles. And in this case, these have been coloured, or false coloured, so that the largest items are red and the smaller ones are white. So you can see here, see all these little tiny denticles covering the head, and there you can see the teeth inside the jaws. But there's a gap between them. Clearly rather different things. And indeed, as sharks get older, they just add more and more denticles that push between the ones that are there already. They don't have this nice replacement pattern like we see in teeth. And in fact, if we look at the edge of the jaw of these in more detail, you can see this. So that's the outside of the jaw, and you can see these, in this case, rather leaf-shaped denticles, and they're rather randomly positioned, they're just sort of jostling for space. But if we tilt it, so we're looking at the jaw edge, here are the teeth, and you can see they're very evenly spaced. In fact, is they alternate, form a zigzag pattern. So row one, we've got teeth like that. Row two, teeth are in the alternate position. So they're already forming this highly constrained pattern. So teeth aren't the same as denticles. That was always one suggestion, the so-called outside-in idea of how teeth evolve. But clearly that's not the case. In this case, by the time the shark is born, it already has all of the tooth positions that it'll have as an adult. It doesn't add any more of these tooth spirals. But in some cases, that doesn't happen. So these are the jaws of a little electric ray. That's an adult. And you can see there, I've just highlighted two of these alternating rows of teeth. And you can see there's quite a lot of them. This is a CT scan of the jaw of an embryo of the same species. And you can see here the first tooth row has two teeth in it, second has three, third has four, fourth has five, and so on. So in this case, unlike the little shark, it's adding an extra tooth each time. And in fact, it appears even in the adult, it's continuously adding teeth. So again, this is something totally different to we see in other vertebrates. Mammals don't do this, lizards don't do this, crocodiles don't do this. So this is a fairly unique feature to some sharks and rays. So we've got teeth which are different to scales, but haven't got any other structures that are a bit sort of toothy and may tell us something. Well, yes, we have groups with a rostrum along a snout with tooth-like structures along it. And we've got at least three of these. We've got the saw sharks, the saw fish, which are a type of ray, and an extinct group of rays as well, so-called scleromyrias. And in each case, we've got a long, hard rostrum with what looks like teeth outside the mouth. Let's have a look at these. Here's some CT scans of a couple of these rostra. That's one of the modern saw shark. And you can see that these tooth-like structures are of different sizes and they have gaps in them. These are basically filling spaces as they come available as the rostrum grows. These are really just modified denticles, modified scales. The saw fish, giant ray, is a little bit different. Here we've got a horizontal slice through it, and you can see here these continuously growing tooth-like structures are sitting in large sockets in the cartilage. We cut it the other way, again, you can see them sitting in these sockets. These aren't being replaced, but these are growing continuously through life. Again, something sharp teeth don't do. But a few unusual scales, like some of the giant fawns you get on the back of some skates, do. So these, again, are rather unusual scales. If we look at this extinct group, this is a fossil from Cretaceous of Lebanon. This is 100 million years old. It's rostrum, and you can see these little tooth-like features along the edge. But we can't see what's underneath it. But if you use a CT scanner, we can. We can virtually remove the rock, which is less X-ray dense than the skeleton. So here, we flip it over, look at the other side. Firstly, we start to see jaws. We can't see in that specimen, because we're looking at the other side of it. We can see extra little tooth-like structures along the underside of the rostrum, as well as the ones along the edge. And again, these don't conform to the pattern we see in teeth. This is effectively showing that these are very weird scales. Now, I usually hate shopping, but there's some sorts of shopping I quite enjoy, and this is one of them. These are some warehouses in northern Morocco where they mine mineral phosphate for fertilizer. And this mineral phosphate is full of fossils. And the locals dig them up and then sell them. So here we've got a warehouse in Seattle. A nice crocodile skull. I think those are plesiosaur vertebrae, carapace, some mosasaur skulls, and giant marine lizards. Again, here this is a rather roadkill but gigantic mosasaur skull. Other bits and pieces around. So it's always worth looking at these. You never quite know what you'll find. And amongst them, we found this very weird rostrum, thing called Shines the Riser. And this is another little piece of it. Okay, so there's the cartilage, and there's these strange little triangular blades along the edge of it. They look much more tooth-like. So here, have we got something else where we've got teeth outside the mouth? Here's some more detailed pictures. Any weird little triangular teeth with these strange multi-lobed roots. But you can see they're sort of almost stacked on top of each other. Very odd. More like what you'd expect if you looked at the replacement teeth inside the jaw of, say, a crocodile. Well, some of these specimens are difficult to interpret, but they help if you see teeth scanned. So here's a piece of rather crushed rostrum with these teeth, so we can rotate it round. Unfortunately, it's stuck in this horrible great lump of rock. But luckily, this rock is slightly less X-ray dense than the fossil. So what we can start to do is look around it and gradually virtually remove the rock. All these little white bits you see coming up in here are probably shark's teeth. The rock's full of them. So here we're removing the rock, and here you can see the rostrum, and all these weird stacked tooth-like features along the outside. And then we can flip it over and look at what was buried in the rock. Otherwise, there's no way we'd be able to see. Here's another specimen we've done the same to. That's what we can see on the surface. Here we've removed the rock and also the roots of these things. And you see, there's not just a few, there's loads of these, all stacked. We do a virtual slice through it. You can see they're stacked inside each other, more like the teeth of a crocodile, with replacement ones coming up underneath. Than a shark. So clearly these aren't shark-type teeth, but they're not normal for shark scales either. This looks to be something, a form of scales that are completely different. What on earth were these things used for? Well, they seem to fit to form this great serrated blade. These rostra are up to 2 meters long. This would have been a formidable structure. Quite the use of it, I don't know. This is an Indian sword, I think it was the 16th century. Again, you can see these serrations along the edge. This is for making shallow, wide cuts. Pretty useful as a defensive structure. Is there anything else in the animal kingdom like that? Well, maybe we have a relative of that helicoprion we saw earlier, with these big spirals. Where rather forming spirals, we get these large blades that project out from the centre of the jaw. Slightly fanciful reconstruction, but it gives you a nice idea of what it's like. And this thing called Adestus, again, seems to have these serrated blades. And one suggestion is it was using these to slash into shoals of fish and ammonites, disable them, and then gobble up what's left. So that gives us these sclerorhynchids, these position as a riser, using this long rostrum with its serrated blades on the edge, maybe digging into the sediment with it, maybe using it as a defence. Remember, this sea is full of those huge great mosasaurs, these 5 to 20 metre long lizards. Now, there was something certainly worth defending themselves from. So what can we say? Well, there's this unique tooth replacement pattern, totally unlike other vertebrates. Teeth are not scales, and even where you have rostra, the teeth are just very, very special scales. And then this weird thing, Schiezer riser, seems to be an additional rostrum bearing group. So it's given us a bit of an idea of how we can interpret of one use of shark's teeth. But here we've looked mostly at modern ones. Can we use them in a larger context to use what we know about modern sharks and using just the teeth, get information about what they did in the past, use them to interpret ancient environments and ancient seas? Well, just going to give you one sort of little example that hopefully shows that you can. So here's a classic photo of someone who's really neatly stacked up lumps of limestone, so you can see the fossils in them, which I thought was very kind of them. Actually, that's slightly untrue. I always thought that these blocks were full of fossils. The whole books say they are. They're not. They've chosen the blocks without any fossils in them because they're nice and shiny and white. However, this surface that they sit on absolutely stuffed with fossils, including bones of a sea cow sticking out, which I'm sure no one had ever noticed before. But rather than looking at the giant proto Toblerone near Cairo, what we were venturing is out into the western desert out here. And you'll notice there's a big green ball out the side of the Nile Valley. That's the Fayum Depression, and includes this large salty lake called Birkit Karun. And this has long been a famous area for fossils. So we have Birkit Karun Lake. North of it, we have rocks of late Eocene and early Oligocene age. So this is 25 to 35 million years old. And these have a range of marine and terrestrial animals in them. And then out to the southwest, we have this area of marine late Eocene rocks called Wadi al-Hitan, which rather gives the game away as that translates to Valley of the Whales. This area has been known for a long time and was first discovered in the 1880s by a German, I wouldn't say archaeologist, I'd say more adventurer called Schweinfurth, and on around Birkit Karun Lake, among other things, he recovered this, which is the jaw of a very primitive whale, but it has teeth more like those of a land mammal. He wasn't an archaeologist, there's several Egyptian or Ptolemaic age ruins there with, in German, sort of Schweinfurth was here, chiselled into them. So, didn't follow the ethics of modern archaeologists, let's say. More of an Indiana Jones. When used these fossils got out, there were several expeditions in the early 20th century, both from based from London and particularly based from the American Museum. These are some photos of how fieldwork used to be done. And here's a picture from one of these early publications. So the American Museum was mostly interested in the north, with lots of land mammals, but it also wandered out here, saw lots of whale bones, and it's called it Zeuglodon Valley, after a name that was then given to a primitive type of whale. And it made the press. These are some famous animals. That's a thing called Arsinoetherium. It's a bizarre creature, actually related to elephants. It was probably aquatic. there's another aquatic elephant thing called Morotherium, and some utterly gigantic snakes. But some things have remained constant. This is a quote from one of the notebooks from the AMH exhibition. A sand life baked up pudding for us. Terribly greasy affair. Olsen and I each buried a piece of the pudding in the sand. And the food hasn't got any better in 110 years since. This is what we end up eating most of the time. Strained fool, which tastes about as appetizing as it looks. Which is basically, it's like refried beans, but without the flavor. And once you've had that three times a day, it gets a little repetitive. So we went to Wadi Al-Hattab, which is now a World Heritage Site, both for the scenery, but particularly for the fossil whales that are all over the place. These are early whales. They've got little back legs, but they couldn't crawl on land. So they're halfway between the land animal and the true whale. And there's a little permanent camp here. Not much wildlife, but there's a rather cute little gecko that tried to use me as a shade from the sun. That is the most amazing scenery. These are Eocene shallow water sandstones that have been sandblasted into the most amazing shapes. It gets used for filming quite a lot. Here's a BBC crew that I went out with on one occasion with the lovely Ian Stewart, so he calls himself. And the rocks here are interesting. They're not only they're full of fossils, but they show a lot of variation. So here we have these shallow water yellow sandstones. And these are full of what appear to be roots of seagrasses. So these look like shallow, sandy underwater prairies filled with seagrass. And among these we get lots of fossils. These are bones of this large early whale called Basilosaurus. That's a skeleton that's been partly excavated, that you can then look at. There's just some bones sticking out of the side of the butte, which are all over the place. And this is the creature itself. And you can see from the skull, the nostrils have not quite migrated up to the top of the head. It's still got teeth more like those of a land animal, but it's already lost the differentiation. It's lost proper canines, for example. It has these weird long vertebrae and it has these little tiny back legs. Completely useless, but modern whales have no back legs at all. They just have a little splinter of bone representing the pelvis. There's other smaller whales. This is another one called Duridon. Basilosaurus was about 15 metres. This one gets to about 4 metres. There's a skeleton of it sort of laid out for all to see. But there's obviously interesting fossils here as well as mammals. That's the rostrum of a large sawfish. It's nearly 2 metres long. And here are yet more bits of whale. This is actually a cross-section through a whale's skull. But if you look in detail, you can start to see interesting things. There's shark sticks in there, which is very reassuring. But you can see that the rocks here vary from shallow to deeper water as we go from one end of the valley to the other, only over a space of maybe 5 kilometres. So here at one end we've got these shallow water yellow sandstones. Here at the other end of the valley, rocks exactly the same age, and we can walk them out to see that at the same level are rather thicker grey mudstones. And in fact, you can see these rocks actually sloping. There's an underwater slope here. So we know that these are deposited in about 30 metres deeper water than those. And there's a little channel there as well. Okay. So I mean, things, there's water flowing down an underwater slope. You can map this out. This pale yellow is sandstone over here. This olivey colour is the mudstone over here. So you can actually follow levels from shallow water to deeper water and collect fossils as you go. And again, you can see that in the cross sections. Fossils are extremely abundant. This is just a weathered surface, so with sharks' teeth lying all over it. But these are broken, they're out of situ. So the best is to try and collect rock and sieve for them. So there we're just sieving some of the sediment. You see the little sharks' teeth popping out. There's my colleague Dave Ward, who I did this with barrels of acetic acid to dissolve all the nasty shells that are in there, making a mess of a World Heritage Site. So we can sample in shallow and deep water. So what we decided to do is we could sample these shallow water sands, both mixed to a whale skeleton, in fact in the rock that it was brought back to from North America in, and away from a whale skeleton. And then we can go into these deep water mudstones in amongst this whale skeleton and away from it, and then in deeper water still. So within one area, we can see what we're getting. Well, the first thing was the incredible diversity of sharks and rays here. I won't bore you with what all of these are, but that's over 70 species. This is up there with the highest diversity of sharks and rays anywhere in the world today. This is up there with sort of northern Australia, southern Indonesia. So incredibly diverse, and includes most of the main groups that are around today. So despite its age, we can look at modern comparisons. And we can see different things in different environments. So in the deeper water, we've got open water predators. We've got mako sharks and thrasher sharks, things that hunt near the surface. We've got very rare examples of this great mega predator, Potodus. Huge serrated teeth. But we've got loads and loads of small stuff. Lots of small things that live on the seafloor with pointy teeth that will eat worms, shrimps, tiny fish. And also lots of teeth of an ancestor of the manta rays who've got plankton feeders. So this is a classic open water fauna. Shallow water at exactly the same age, only a couple of kilometres away, utterly different. No, or virtually no, big midwater predators, but instead we've got smallish things that live near the seafloor. Lemon sharks and whaler sharks, just as we get today. One of the commonest things is this, a weasel shark. Today, all of their relatives are specialists in hunting squid, cuttlefish and octopus, usually in seagrass beds. So this is a specialist little octopus hunter. We've got rays with grinding teeth that are feeding on crabs and shells, and we've got lots of small rays, things that bury themselves in the sediment and eat worms and shrimps and so on. Stingrays, guitarfish. Around the whale skeletons, different thing again. What we're not getting are big scavengers. Those big mega predator otodus, we've got one broken tooth, which had probably broken into a bone and snapped. The only sort of scavenger we're getting is this small tiger shark, which is presumably coming in, taking the last bits of flesh off its bones. But what we're getting instead are these small seafloor dwellers with the sort of teeth you'd expect them to be generalist eaters. They're usually taking small fish, shrimps, maybe old crab, maybe old octopus. But probably ambush feeders. And also ambush feeders like butterfly ray, who takes little shrimps and spends most of its time buried in the sand, nurse sharks, and electric rays. Probably the laziest of all ambush predators. Just lies under the sand and a fish swims over its head and it zaps it with huge voltage and then swallows down the paralyzed food. So here we can see, even just by looking at teeth, by using a comparator to modern sharks, we can really start to use them to build up what's happening on the seafloor. So we've got this extremely high diversity, but even though this is 35 million years ago. It's very modern in its time. Completely unlike the whale. You know, the whale wouldn't pass as modern. Most of these sharks would. Huge diversity of teeth, indicating lots of different diets and lots of different feeding strategies. Many of these species are highly specific to either shallow water or deep water or around the whales. So what does whales mean? Well, we're not getting what we expected of lots of scavengers. Anything but. We're getting lots of tiny to small ambush predators. So what these whale skeletons seem to be doing is forming little reefs on this otherwise featureless seafloor, because the bones were probably covered in seaweeds and sponges. They were probably also dripping oil for a long time, as modern whale bones do. So there was probably methane and drips of oil coming up to the surface, feeding lots of microbes. There's probably great streamers of cyanobacteria coming off from where these bones are, even after they've been buried. And this all formed perfect hiding places and hunting grounds for these ambush predators to lurk in amongst the seaweeds, the sponges, and the bacteria. So it shows we've got a lot of potential for using sharks in a range of different ways to study evolution and development of teeth. Because they're so abundant, they have a huge potential for looking at ancient environments and ancient ecology. And as we start using new techniques, both very high-tech, like CT scanning, and extremely low-tech, like collecting large weights of sediment and putting them through little sieves, and then getting rid of the shell of the acetic acid, we can greatly add to the amount of data that we can get out of this. So what I hope I've done is given you an insight into really how we can link together aspects of marine biology and aspects of paleontology to greatly increase our knowledge of both, knowledge of marine animals, past and present, and also show what that means on a much bigger context. See how we can use that to look at some of the fundamentals of the evolution of vertebrates, and also how we can generate new tools, such as looking at how we can interpret these what appear at first to be featureless yellow marine sandstones in a way that we can get much more out of the ecology of what was happening in those seas at that point in time. Okay, so hopefully that sort of has sparked people's interests. And I think if anyone's got any questions, I'd be only too happy to answer. Questions?
Charlie.
Must have done it well.
Yes.
It's a very good question how quickly the sharks replace their teeth. Some big sharks in aquaria, you can do it by looking to see how many teeth there are left at the bottom of the tank, particularly in a quarantine tank where there's no gravel on the bottom. And some of the bigger, more impressive sharks that aquaria have, they seem to replace every a new tooth comes up every week or two. Things with these big crushing teeth, clearly they often very, very highly worn away, and the wearing flat doesn't affect their use, so they probably replace much less commonly. But on the other hand, some rays have huge numbers of tiny little hook-like teeth, and they probably replace them every few days. So it varies dramatically between different types. Very, very little work's been done on it. So apart from, you know, what I do know comes effectively from obscure veterinary journals of things from Aquaria. No. We do actually now have a reasonable idea how its jaw worked. It's a partial skull that's been found.
Right.
What it didn't do is this thing didn't stick out of the front of the jaw like a big circular saw, as was always thought, but is probably largely embedded in the lower jaw with just this ridge of blades sticking out of the top and front. So it may well be that if it's retaining the teeth in the front of the jaw, and they're still functional, there's at that point no point losing them, because they're already starting to come back in into the jaw anyway. Sharks, unlike other vertebrates, lack the enzymes to reabsorb phosphate. So whereas we have this dynamic bone which we're continually reabsorbing, reprecipitating, sharks can't do that. So they are continuously losing phosphate material, and they can't reshape their bone. They have to add bits on. So they have a rather different, probably phosphate balance to us, which we don't really understand.
You mentioned that the shark fossils are very similar to modern-day equivalents, but just anywhere in the world, has there been any discoveries of sharks from the Eocene that go against this trend, or has shark evolution by this point it's not very experimental?
There are, even from the Eocene, there are some weird and wonderful forms. If it were to put that list up, there's a couple of things I've put as unknown, or past it, haven't I? A couple of things I've put as uncertain affinity. There's two of these. One is a weird thing called odontoritis. We have no idea what it is. It's a spike-shaped tooth with a barb that points back on it and a weird two-lobed root, completely unlike Mathilinia sharks. And another is a thing called Archimanto, which has nothing to do with mantas, where the root is just like a blob and the tooth is a hook. We have no idea what either of these are. Archimantis is almost certainly a plankton feeder, which tend to have teeth that are really reduced and not a hook-like. But what it was, it's not a ray, you know, its microstructure is wrong, so it's a shark of the type we have no idea. And as this other thing, odontoritis, anyone would guess. It was thought to be an anglerfish until quite recently. And so the people who work on anglerfish go, no, it's not one of ours, it must be one of yours, you saw it there. So even relatively recently, we've got some pretty weird stuff.
Could you explain a bit more about dentals? That actually the skin, that on the skin of the shark, do other sea creatures have dentals? They're
special. They're essentially special scales. They're often rather leaf-shaped or tooth-like, with a root which is often a little sort of flattened disc underneath them, which is embedded in the skin. So they're part of the skin covering. Normal fish scales, overlap and form a nice regular pattern. These tend to form very irregular patterns, and new ones just fill gaps as they fall. When we go right back to the really oldest vertebrates, the earliest vertebrates, they have things that are almost halfway between a shark denticle and a fish scale. They tend to have these sort of rhombic things that were clearly embedded in the skin, didn't overlap, but also weren't replaced and didn't grow continuously either. So there are a form of skin covering. It appears that they predate the evolution of teeth because there are rocks about 410, 420 million years old that have lots of shark-like denticles in, but no teeth. So it seems the earliest sharks didn't have teeth, but did have this skin covering.
It's not paleology, but paleontology. But is there genetic evidence from modern species as to whether there's common evolution between bony and non-bony?
Absolutely. This is something which I've avoided. Yes, the genes, which I'm trying to recall exactly which do which, because I'll get it wrong. The genes that express for the formation of the tooth bud are the same in sharks and in bony animals, and are different to the genes that express for the formation of scales in bony fish. What we don't know is what genes express for the formation of denticles in sharks and whether they're the same. So it might be we have some, as you get with a lot of Hox gene complex, something that's so deeply rooted in evolution that it ends up doing wildly different things in different organisms, but it's the same sort of control, or whether it's something that's appeared rather later and could be put forward as an argument for the single development of teeth. There is work going on at the moment to see exactly how denticles are controlled, and that might be the key to this.
So if there are no more questions, I'd like to thank Charlie and invite you outside for drinking and snack.